There are different type of statistical learning problems. For example, I discussed already the problem where you try to predict the future number of claims. However, another problem could be that you are trying to understand, is this company defaulting in the next year, for example. If you buy bonds of a company, well, that's a relevant question. But it's very different from the first one. In the first one, you try to predict a number, no claims, one claim, two claims, three claims, and so on. Whereas in the second problem, you have only two options. You default or you will not default. Or it could be that you are looking at all your customers in your portfolio and you want to see, do they form natural groups? Because if your customers are clustering together in several clusters, then you can maybe start with investigating each cluster. See if the behavior in each cluster is different. Or it could be that you have a very large data set of 100 variables and you're trying to understand, can I maybe remove some of the variables? Can I make this data set smaller, only using 60 variables, and still having enough information to make my predictions, for example? So these are all different types of problems. And they require different solutions. So what we will do in this video, we will try to understand how can we identify different types of problems. We can divide our learning problems in two groups. We have supervised learning on the one hand, unsupervised learning on the other hand. Let's start with the supervised learning. In supervised learning, you have a response variable y. And y is, as I already explained in the previous video, y is the variable you are looking at, you are interested in. It's, for example, the number of claims of your policyholders. It is the value of Bitcoin in the next year. It means that if you make a prediction, then how good or bad your prediction is depends on the realization of y. What does it mean? It means that if you are predicting the number of claims in the next year, for all your policyholders, and you do that today. Now what you can do is you can wait for 1 year. You make your predictions, you wait for 1 year. After 1 year, you can look back. For each policyholder, you can check what is the number of claims he or she actually had in this last year, and what was my prediction. If I have someone who had four claims, and I predicted four, I'm very good. I predicted correct. If then you have the next one who had three claims, I predicted two. I didn't predict the exact number. I'm still close. And then you have someone who had no claims at all, and I predicted six claims. That's very bad. And that's what we mean with supervised learning. There is a supervisor, the response variable, that tells us if we are doing a good job or if we are not doing a good job. The popular algorithms for supervised learning are regression and, for example, decision trees. Unsupervised learning means there is no response variable. So there is no one that can teach us if we are on the right track, if we are doing a good job or a bad job. Because if we have this response variable in supervised learning, and we see that we are making big errors, so we are very bad, very far away from Y, we know, well, we have to change. We know we have to improve our algorithm. So that is the supervision, the teaching that the response variable is doing. In unsupervised learning, it's not there. For example, a problem could be you have to find structure in your data, right? You have to say these observations are very similar. And these observations are very similar. You want to cluster, group your observations. Then there is no response variable that tells us, well, you were correct that this was a group, you are correct that this was a group. Right? So you have no response variable, no supervisor when you do unsupervised learning. And for example, clustering is a popular unsupervised learning. PCA also. Unsupervised learning. Principal component analysis is an example of a dimension reduction technique. And in most cases, it's unsupervised learning. It means that you have a large data set, many variables, and you try to get rid of some of the variables. Instead of using 100 variables, you only want to use 60 variables. So if you are just looking at how can I reduce the number of variables, then you have unsupervised learning. However, you can also have a supervised version of your dimension reduction. For example, think about the example with the number of claims. If you have lots of predictor variables, you can say, well, let's investigate if I can reduce the dimension of my data set. So I'm not looking at Y, I'm looking at my predictor variables. Maybe I have 500 predictor variables. I only want to keep 100. When are we doing a good job? Well, we are going to predict our claim Y, the claim number Y, first with all the variables, and then we apply our dimension reduction techniques. We have a reduced data set, and we also are going to predict the number of claims. And then we will see if we can still accurately predict the number of claims, if we do not lose too much accuracy while reducing the number of variables. In that case, we have a response that tells us, well, you did a good job or you did a bad job. If we reduce the number of variables, but suddenly we cannot predict at all, we get huge prediction errors, well, then we say, well, this is maybe too much. We reduce the dimensions a bit too much. We have to increase again, right? So that is an example of supervised dimension reduction. Within the space of differing statistical learning problems, you also have the regression problems on the one hand and the classification problems on the other hand. Let's start with the regression problems. In the regression problems, the response variable, the variable you want to predict, is quantitative. It means that the outcomes of that variable can be ordered. You can say, well, this is the first outcome, the first observation, this is the second observation, and the second observation is larger or smaller than the first one. There is an ordering relation. For example, if you predict the number of stocks, the value of your Bitcoin and so on, these are examples of quantitative variables. The other problem are the classification problems. When we do classification, as the name suggests, we are classifying observations. If you classify observations, there is no ordering between the different classes. Assume that you have to assign a color to each observation. You have red, green, and blue. There is no ordering relation between these two. Red is not closer to green than it is to blue. They are just different classes. It means that if we look at predictions that are wrong, then it's a different thing when we are in the regression setting than when we are in the classification setting. In the regression setting, you can predict something, your Y, then you look at your realization of Y, and you can say, well, we are wrong, and this is the error. You can say we are wrong, but only a little bit. Or maybe you can say we are completely wrong. If you think that a stock will grow to the value of 100 and it turns out it's only 10, well, you have a huge error. If you predict it's 100 and it turns out to be 99, it's very accurate. If you do the same thing with classification, you cannot do that anymore, because you're now saying, well, we predict something, we predict it's red, and it turns out to be green. Again, I have the wrong prediction. But now I cannot specify my error. I cannot say, well, now we predicted red, but it is green, but that's not too bad. No, there is no error, no distance that I can use to say I'm close or far away with my prediction from the observation. So we have, for example, techniques as linear models, Gauss-Poisson regression, that can be used for regression problems. We have classification algorithms that can be used to classify observations in different classes. And then you have techniques such as what we call KNN, K nearest neighbor, decision trees also. These are statistical methods that can be used for classification and for regression problems. You see here an overview of your different learning problems. So you have, first of all, you have supervised and unsupervised learning. And an example of unsupervised learning is clustering. Grouping your different observations in clusters. When we do supervised learning, there is a response variable. And depending on the response variable being quantitative or categorical, you have the regression and the classification problems. And then you have the problems that can be both supervised or unsupervised learning. That is the dimension reduction, for example.